Gonna get started on reading Deaf Republic by Ilya Kaminsky for our Bicoastal Buddy read for April. I'm really excited. I know that Michelle has already read this. I have not, but I watched the Poets Corner's review of it, and it sounds very powerful. It sounds very timely and incredible, so I'm really excited to get started on this one.
I just painted them, so don't judge, but I have fresh nails. Okay.
I mean, what are you supposed to say when the first poem comes across as like extremely powerful as this? I mean, just the line, "I was in my bed, around my bed, America was falling." It's gonna be a heavy book, but I think it's gonna be really good because this first poem it's heavy, but it's incredible. Okay, the formatting is fantastic because already the like second poem is the dramatis personae. I don't know if I'm saying that right. It's a detail. It's when you read a play, there's like the breakdown of who the characters are, and it's that. And the very next thing we go into is Act Two. So I wonder if this is going to be a play told in poetry. I wonder how much that's going to affect everything else, or if it was just kind of like its own type of poem, its own kind of setup. It'll be interesting to see. So at first I thought I was probably going to like read through this in a sitting because it's a poetry book. It's not like with a novel where I'm going to be sitting. It's going to be days of vlogging for this, but this is really heavy, and kind of sitting with each poem, it's very heavy. The next poem is called Gunshot, and the last line made me tear up pretty bad. So I'm gonna probably need some time with this. I'm glad I started it early. I mean, I think that's good poetry, does force you to kind of sit back and really like digest it, but also like, maybe I'm just being a little extra sensitive right now too, but it's a book about some really heavy subjects, and I think it's gonna keep kind of hitting me. So this might be a slow read for a poetry book for me. I should probably read the back at least, but I don't know how much of this is like directly biographical or how much of it is just a story, but it's pretty heavy. But there's this line I wanted to read. It says, "At the trial of God, we will ask, why did you allow all this? And the answer will be an echo. Why did you allow all this?" Which is very interesting. From this point in the book, the main character, Alfonso's wife, Sonia, has been shot, like dragged out into the street and shot by the soldiers. And then he kind of drunkenly killed a drunk soldier who they had found. And then that part. There's a lot of this, this quiet rebellion. And then also the people just being people and still living. And, you know, like the happiness of life. As well as like these atrocities. These soldiers doing these horrible things. And these people getting, you know, picked up in the streets and dragged away for no reason. And then... but that this retaliation, this like brutal murder also, that it ends with that line, that the answer will be an echo. Why did you allow all this? It was really poignant.
Hi, what you doing?
I think I like the second act even more than I liked the first act. The first act, I was sort of scared for them the whole time, and then obviously it turns out very tragic. In the second act, it's a lot of like a different kind of resistance, a very, how to put it, that the women are using their bodies against the soldiers in retaliation, and it's pretty powerful. But also then that, of course, that becomes then the thing that the soldiers use against them as well. And I really like that they have these ones in each section, these questions. What is the only thing that's changed is the word, this word. What is blank, the quiet between two bombardments? And in each section, it's sort of been the turning point of the chapter. Like, people have raised this resistance, and it has worked for so long, and now the soldiers are fighting back, and now the tragedy is gonna strike. This is a heavy book. It really is. This is realities of living in occupied territory, the realities of resistance from a very human level, from like the people doing the action, the people suffering because of it. And yeah, it is really powerful. I'm probably gonna get this book finished and give you my thoughts at the end, what I thought of the whole thing. Okay, so I just finished the book and holy crap. So we have this play of this reality of this occupation of living in this country that is just torn by occupation and war. And then the very last poem of the book, oh my God, it's called In a Time of Peace. It's got me choked up again because it's about his life in America and how, in this peaceful country, there's the line, the body of a boy lies on the pavement exactly like the body of a boy, which is a repeated line from back earlier. And just tying that back in, it makes it so clear how fucked up this country is, too. Oh, tying this whole story of his country in, I believe he's from the former Soviet Union, tying that back into what's been going on here with the police brutality, and it's heavy. I might have to have a box of tissues when we talk about it. The poems were good. There were parts that were just, I have so many lines underlined where it was just like shockingly good lines. And so many poems that were just like standout poems, but they all tie together into this story, this full picture of what revolution is and what it looks like and what going on with your life despite it looks like. The deafness in this kind of represents like a strength and a failing. I mean, like they're deaf as a revolution, but they're also deaf as a trying to cope and get on with their life and ignoring the fact that people are dying every time they try to resist. The deafness is America, and the way we just continue to see gun violence. I mean, earlier this week was the shooting in Boulder. Luckily, no one I know lives in the area anymore, but a friend of mine used to live right there. Like when I asked her if she'd heard anything, she was like, that's the King Soopers she used to go to. My cousin's family used to live in that exact area. Like, I've been there, I've been to that King Soopers before. So. And you know, right now we're dealing with some really rampant violence against Asian, especially Asian women in our country. And like, yeah, it's got all these thoughts out. It's got all these thoughts out. I've got my tissue now. You know, one of the things that's been constantly on my mind, you know, kind of you push it to the back, but it's always there. It's like, I hope Josh's mom is gonna be okay. Coming to and from work every day. Like, she works a late shift. She's been fine so far. She's been like reasonably careful, but you know, like there's always a danger, but there's a much higher danger now, apparently, in this country if you're an older Asian woman. And so, like, it's a real fear. And my husband was recently talking about how he feels guilty because he is half Asian, that he can pass for white, that many people don't look at him and see him as Asian, and right now it makes him feel guilty. You know, like, it is a privilege, but it is also a source of guilt because, you know, he's kind of feels like he's outside of this and that he's not representing, and it is really heavy. It's a heavy collection. It's just brought up a lot of thoughts, a lot of things going on and that don't get better, and kind of the helplessness and the way it's like everything in your life seems so important until it's not there anymore. And it feels like, oh, all these other things, like these revolutions, these people, like what they're doing is dangerous. And I have these other things, these other commitments going on, and I need to do those. And it's just like, that's how things don't change. Because you carry on with your life doing the same thing over and over. And so they don't have to change. Oh, hi, Pi. Most of us aren't going to, like, radically change the world on our own, but how often could we have been an extra drop in the bucket that could have, you know, created the tidal wave? Is it all about you? I forgot. If I'm filming, it needs to be about Pi. Okay. Oh, thank you. Now you've sent it out of focus, mister. All right. Come down here and sit with me. Come here. We'll say bye. I think that's gonna wrap it up for the Deaf Republic. The live show with Shellyflowers Reads and Writes is going to be on April 4th at 12 o'clock Pacific Standard Time. It'll be 3 o'clock Eastern Standard Time. I'll have links to that down below so you can watch it and join us. And if you've read the book, definitely join in. I'm excited to see. Excited is not the right word with this book. I'm interested to see Shellyflowers' thoughts, because this was a really heavy one, and I may have to bring a box of tissues. I'm glad I'm, like, finishing this in advance, so I'll have a few days to regain my spirit. And to kind of pull my thoughts together, and yeah, we talk about just the poetry level, which is really good and really interesting, and the structure level. This book is structured very interestingly with the, like, play setup. But in a way, like, that setup, whereas it could often be used to kind of remove you from the pain and the action, somehow in the poetry model, somehow with the poetry model, it made it, like, more personal, more impactful. Hi, yes. Oh, thank you. I think he's upset because I'm upset, so. All right, I'm gonna go. And yeah, join us for our live show. And like I said, it'll be listed down below. And yeah, I definitely recommend reading this one. But it was heavy. So, all right. Talk to you again soon. Bye.